of the world's newest democracies. But, you know, I prepared this before I knew what Frank was going to say, so I just want you to know that. I was going to say I would be remiss if I failed to point out the diplomatic skills of our own Dr. Frank Bird, who truly applies diplomacy 101 behind the scenes as he dishes up Baltimore's Foreign Trade Council members' star-studded casts. And he keeps on doing that. You heard him say tonight, it'll be our 64th ambassador, 64th country, on February the 4th. How lucky we are indeed to have him. And what I am referring to specifically is his behind-the-scenes maneuvering to get me to introduce Dr. Miomir Zuzul. I forgot to ask you how to pronounce it. As usual. Okay. Frank, of course, knows, as you heard, my Serbian background and the hours of agony I've spent over the unfortunate situation in the Balkans and the old Yugoslavia. So Dr. Bird said, Helen, you were too late to introduce Joe Stern last time. Now you owe me. And before I could say, owe you for what, he continued, we'd like to have you introduce Ambassador Zuzul of Croatia on the 23rd. His tone was so diplomatic and his request so definite that I didn't even dare tease him about another Balkan volcano. Actually, I am very pleased and honored that he asked me, and particularly after meeting and chatting a bit with Ambassador Zuzul here this evening. As I remarked to him, I said, I think you're the first psychologist that I've met who has become an ambassador. And he said, well, I think you may be right. And he said, more interestingly, the first child psychologist. But he didn't study to be a child psychologist. He studied to be a psychologist. And even with that background, and in the short time, I mean short when I look at the, he is tall, when you see. He's a tall height of it, and I'm the short of it. When you realize in the rather short period of time that Croatia has been an independent country, he has gained quite a bit of diplomatic experience. In addition to his position as ambassador to the U.S., he's also the Croatian president's special envoy for negotiations and work with the contact group and other representatives of the international community, a post he's held since 1994, and which has taken him to the peace negotiations in Vienna, Paris, and Dayton. Dr. Zuzul is also head of the Committee for Foreign Policy and International Relations to the Presidential Council of the Republic of Croatia. Before coming to Washington, he was Croatia's permanent representative to the United Nations Office in Geneva, National Security Advisor to the President of Croatia, and Deputy Minister of Foreign Affairs of Croatia. Dr. Zuzul's diplomatic career, however, only started in 1992 after he served as a volunteer in the Croatian Army, defending his country against the Yugoslav aggression. Prior to enlisting in the Army, Dr. Zuzul, who holds a PhD, and this is what I was talking about, in social psychology from the University of Zagreb, has been head of the university's Department of Developmental Psychology. I gotta take psychology. He also served as vice dean of the University of Zagreb's Faculty of Arts and Sciences since 1990. No stranger to the United States, he was a visiting professor at the University of Pittsburgh from 1988 to 1990, during which time he also lectured at several other universities in the United States and Europe. He's the author of 3 books and editor of another 3, and he's published more than 50 research papers and given presentations at more than 30 international scientific conferences. In addition to his native Croatian, he speaks fluent English, French, and Italian. And he's married to the former Titania Bradvica, and they have 4 children, Ivana, Tiona, Mihailov, and Andrija. And as I said, when he stands up now, You're going to see that he's the tall of it and I'm the real short of it. Very good. My pleasure, Mr. Ambassador. My honor. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Madam Helen Delich Bentley. Thank you very much, Mr. Bird. But after all those kind words, after everything that you said about myself, I'm afraid that whatever I say can only make picture that you can create about me worse. So it would be better if I do not speak at all. Just present myself, say that's I am probably taller than average, not in Croatia, but certainly here. And that was it. But since obviously you would like to see what I have to tell you now in the second part of, it's not proper to say second part of my life, but certainly in my second career in the life, because I spent most of my life working in science, teaching, preparing maybe even to continue in that. And if someone asked me only 5-6 years ago what I will be doing if one day 6 years from now, if someone said me, you know, you will be a couple of years from now, or if I had a dream in that time in this beautiful building with this beautiful view with those group of people, that wouldn't surprise me. I would think that that is quite a realistic dream. But if someone told me what will be my role and what I am going to be telling you about, I think that I wouldn't believe. That was beyond any reality and anything that I ever think. When I said that, somehow incidentally, the area that I done most research in that time, even the books that Madam Bentley Delich mentioned, were somehow connected with this, because my topic of scientific interest was aggressive behavior. But of course, from very, very different perspective, from very different point of view than I have maybe now, because unfortunately no one in that time could believe that one day we will be facing something which is really beyond something that one can imagine or that one can put in one specialist scientific book. But it is really true that maybe because of that orientation, maybe because although it is the fact that my diplomatic or political career started with the moment when I volunteered for Croatian army, and again something that I never thought or I never could believe that can happen in my life. All my life I used to think that army is certainly something not very pleasant and probably not necessary institution. For example, I often say that my favorite book was and still it is, to tell you frankly, Catch 22 by Joseph Heller. But, you know, that is something life has really ways to go beyond any imagination and any fiction. So it really happened that I became first soldier in a Croatian army, and then through that I was involved in politics and finally in diplomacy. But somehow I am proud to say in front of all of you that I think and I truly believe that all the time I try to contribute to the peace. And it is really the fact that last 3 years, if someone asked me what was the most important part of my job, and it was not only by time that I was spending, but also and energy, but really by importance, was that I try to contribute to present Croatian view and Croatian perspectives, but also to contribute to come to the peace through negotiation. And I am also very proud that I was part of Dayton negotiation process and the Croatian team who finally, we believe, helped to establish the peace in that part of Europe. But I am telling you all that simply because of that you maybe are expecting that something from that will be in my presentation this evening. But that's not fact. There is something. But I decided intentionally, together with my collaborator, to present you view that we have, not on the recent events on Croatia, of course, that everyone who wants to know my opinion and information that I might have regarding that, I will be more than pleased to share that with you. But to present what is our looking into future of Europe and how we see the role and the position of Republic now, sovereign and independent Republic of Croatia, in that process, in that future Europe. So if you allow me, I will maybe spend some 20-25 minutes to present you something that it is my personal thinking, but also very much on the line of official position of the Republic of Croatia regarding the processes which are going on in Europe, but which are also certainly very important from the perspective of the United States. The collapse of communism and the end of the Cold War present a unique opportunity for the development of new Europe. For the first time since the Great War, I mean First World War, Europe has been reunited in its fundamental assumptions and aspirations. Our task is now to build a new concert of Europe composed of countries that share both a common heritage and a common commitment to democracy, free markets and individual liberty. This concert must include the United States, which is in fact, if not geographically, the leading European power. Having won the Cold War, America must not retreat into isolation. This is not merely for the benefit of Europe, but also for the benefit of the United States. If nothing else, the 20th century has proven that the security of the United States is linked to the security of Europe. The United States has fought three wars, the World Wars and the Cold War in Europe since 1917, to avoid domination of the continent by single power, which might then threaten the American heartland and to defend the principles of democracy. These goals have been achieved, but the achievement is not secure. Although the Soviet threat has disappeared and Russian troops no longer bivouac a few hundred miles from the North Sea, there remains a tremendous potential for military, political, and economic instability in Europe. This does not mean that the continent is verging on a return to the awful division of the Cold War, or that the modern plagues of communism or fascism are once again about to break out. However, the future of Russian democracy is uncertain, and the expectations of many in the emerging democracies, as well as the population of those countries still in the process of democratization, often remain unfulfilled. No one believes that the damage suffered through war, Cold War, and economic stagnation can be repaired overnight. However, the commitment to democratic institutions and market economies of the new democracies of Central and Eastern Europe is sure to be tested and soon. It is perhaps another of the 20th century's violent lessons that the problems of military security and political and economic aspirations are inherently linked and cannot be addressed separately. American leadership will remain critical in order to complete Europe's transformation to an economically integrated and politically stable whole. And we believe this new European concert must be achieved. If the sweep of Europe's history is examined, the inescapable conclusion is that peace has most often been assured when the continent is a whole, sharing a consensus of values and aspiration. By the same token, peace has most often been endangered and lost when Europe has been divided into mutually suspicious or hostile camps. At the close of Europe's bloodiest century, there is a genuine opportunity to build a new European consensus. This opportunity should not be squandered through the creation or continuation of system of security haves and have-nots. We believe that the best mechanism to complete this process is the continuation of a strong and enlarged NATO. NATO is the political and security institution that, more than any other factor, is responsible for the past 50 years of peace, stability and prosperity in Western Europe. The driving purpose of the Atlantic Alliance was to stop Soviet expansions, but its character always has been much more than merely a military alliance. Over the past 40 years, it prevented further Soviet expansion in Europe, either through military attack or political subversion, gave American leadership in Europe a permanent institutional structure, and provided a shattered Germany with a stable and honorable relationship to the Western allies, while it reconstructed itself along Western democratic lines. In rebuilding Europe and maintaining the peace, NATO is surely the single most successful military and political alliance in modern history. Its value to the United States was recently recognized by Congress in the NATO Enlargement Act of 1996, where that body stated that NATO has played an essential role in guaranteeing the security, freedom, and prosperity of the United States. This success can now be preserved, consolidated, and extended only by bringing in NATO's framework the emerging democracies of Central and Eastern Europe. We are pleased that the Clinton administration has endorsed the early expansions of NATO alliance. We fully support the administration's efforts to bring the Visegrad countries, Poland, Hungary, and the Czech Republic into NATO, and its recognition that other states in Central and Eastern Europe should be admitted to full NATO membership in due course. We also applaud the action of the Congress in passing the NATO Enlargement Facilitation Act last fall. The legislation recognized in a tangible form that the importance of NATO expansions to the United States security interest, and made clear that such expansion was and hopefully will remain a bipartisan effort. At that time, the Congress also recognized in the report accompanying the legislation that Croatia should in its turn be considered for NATO membership, making clear that the United States should, quoting, support the active participation of Croatia in activities appropriate for qualifying for NATO membership. For our part, let me assure you that Croatia is eager to move forward the full NATO membership, and that is both able and willing to assume the full responsibilities such membership entails. Croatia is fully committed to the commonly shared values and goals of the Western European democracies and those of the United States. For most of their history, the Croatian people have been an integral part of the so-called West. Indeed, as early as the 9th century, much of Croatia was incorporated into Charlemagne's Frankish Empire, and for most of its early modern history, Croatia was governed by the Habsburgs, whose other possessions over time encompassed Austria, Bohemia, Hungary, Belgium, and the Netherlands, parts of Italy, Spain, and Spanish America, including, what surprised many people here, Florida and the territory which now constitutes the states of California, Nevada, Arizona, New Mexico, and Texas. With the exception of its inclusion in Yugoslavia at the close of World War I, Croatia is and always has been a Western country. In the years since the collapse of the communistic Yugoslavia, Croatia has reasserted and defended its independence and has established a fully functioning democratic political structure. It has a constitution which guarantees its citizens the same fundamental rights assured by other Western constitutions, and has held successful elections which have been monitored and declared to be free and fair by international organizations. Croatia's military is firmly subject to civilian control, and it is actively cooperating with NATO's Dayton implementation force in Bosnia and Herzegovina. Croatia's intelligence and police forces are also under civilian control, and along with the military, share technical data and intelligence information with NATO and United Nations forces. This is not to say, of course, that no improvement is necessary, and this improvement will come. Building democracy is, as history proves, a long and difficult process. Each of Western European democracies have in their time experienced setbacks. France, for example, has experienced two monarchies, two empires, and five republics in the past 200 years. Croatia, however, is committed to establishing and preserving a stable constitutional democracy that will endure. There is an obvious internal impetus for this evolving maturation of Croatian democracy. The Croatian people want to enjoy all of democracy's benefits. Nevertheless, close cooperation with an eventual membership in Western security, political, and economic institutions will expedite this process. When NATO was established, German democracy was in its infancy, and the survival of democratic regimes in other Western European states, such as Italy or Greece, was in doubt. More than anything else, it was the stabilizing influence of NATO membership that assured the survival of democratic institutions in Western Europe, and that influence can and should now assure their success in Central and Eastern Europe. Moreover, Croatia is well able to undertake the obligations of NATO membership. Demographically, Croatia has a highly educated and motivated workforce. In the 6 years following the achievement of its independence, Croatia has built and significantly developed a healthy and expanding economy despite a tragic war that resulted in almost 10,000 deaths and estimated $27 billion in damages. It has instituted an aggressive privatization program and enjoys a robust economy. Inflation has stabilized at approximately 3.7% annually, and economic growth in the past several years has been between 5 and 7%. Our economic performance now is comparable to that of Czech Republic and Slovenia, and our economy can be expected to continue its solid growth as the government's privatization program proceeds and our infrastructure is rebuilt and improved. In addition, NATO will gain significant strategic benefits from the inclusion of Croatia. Croatia borders on Slovenia and Hungary, both slated for eventual NATO membership, and shares the northern Adriatic sea coast with Italy. Croatia's sea coast and ports are highly valuable from both a strategic and tactical perspective, and Croatia's eastern border on Danube, once its eastern Slavonia territory is fully reintegrated to Croatian authority, will ensure that this vital inland waterway remains open to commerce and trade. In this regard, Croatia already has proven its strategic worth to NATO by serving as both a staging ground and headquarters to at least 4 international peacekeeping operations, including NATO's IFOR and S4 now. Indeed, as part of its implementation of the peace process in Bosnia and Herzegovina, Croatia has cooperated closely with NATO forces and will continue to work with NATO and the contact group to ensure the security of those forces and the successful completion of their mission. Croatia believes that this experience has trained it well for cooperating with, supporting and implementing NATO's mission in general. We are already taking concrete steps toward achieving NATO membership. We moved quickly to fulfill the requirements set for the framework document of the Partnership for Peace program, which is the first essential step toward joining NATO's Partnership for Peace. Croatia's potential for Partnership for Peace membership has been acknowledged on several occasions by United States Defense Secretary William Perry and a number of other United States officials, including President Clinton. Although Partnership for Peace provides a framework for each of the new Central and Eastern European democracies to advance at its own speed and terms, such flexibility should not compromise the likelihood nor the ultimate quality of the NATO partnership. In this regard, Croatia views its future participation in Partnership for Peace and other regional security and defense systems as a vehicle to full integration into the Atlantic Alliance. We strongly believe that there are no realistic alternatives to full integration of the new democracies, including Croatia, into NATO. If left to chance, the post-Cold War European landscape can quickly succumb to instability. The case of Croatia, and even more so Bosnia and Herzegovina, the very places where Europe and the international community temporarily abdicated their responsibilities, prove the point best. Some have suggested that potential local conflicts should disqualify a country from NATO membership. We vigorously disagree. If that were a disqualifying factor, then neither Greece nor Turkey, both NATO members, could now qualify for membership and could not have qualified when they originally joined the alliance. The primary consideration for NATO membership should be commitment to NATO's principles, the ability to contribute tangible resources and strategic and tactical value to the alliance. On each point, we believe Croatia is fully qualified for NATO membership. Indeed, in working hard for peace in our region, Croatia has proven itself to be a mature and reliable treaty partner. Over the last several years, in the face of aggression, the government of Croatia has vigorously pursued peace and stability for itself and its neighbors. In August 1995, Croatia used limited military force to restore law and order in areas of its territory that had been occupied by paramilitary forces who, after ethnically cleansing the areas they control, hoped to join the greater Serbian state to be carved out of Bosnia and Croatia. Although Croatia was criticized by some for its Operation Storm, it was this action that checked the forces of aggression in both Bosnia and Croatia and which ultimately opened the door for Dayton Accords, the first peace plan for the region with real chance of success. Of course, the United States deserves much of the credit for bringing an end to hostilities in our region by fostering the dialogue that led to the Dayton Accords and the Washington Agreement. The United States' continuing involvement in implementation of those agreements in Bosnia and Herzegovina also has been a critical stabilizing influence. Let me also take this opportunity to assure you that Croatia is committed to the peace process and to the full implementation of Dayton and Washington Agreement. In that regard, Croatia fully supports the Croat Muslim Federation in Bosnia and Herzegovina and hopes for continuing improvement in its bilateral relation with Serbia and Montenegro or New Yugoslavia, especially now after we finally signed a document of mutual recognition within the internationally recognized borders. In this regard, Croatia also is committed to maintaining the high standards of human rights. For two consecutive years, surveys by USIA have shown that Croats are among the most tolerant people in Europe. In addition, Croatia is fully cooperating with the International Criminal Tribunal for the former Yugoslavia in its efforts to investigate and prosecute those who committed war crimes in our region, regardless of their nationality or the side that they were fighting for. To that end, the Croatian constitution was amended by special constitutional act to formalize cooperation with the tribunal. This new law created procedures whereby suspects wanted by the tribunal may be extradited to The Hague and provisions that allow the tribunal to operate on Croatian territory. The tribunal has, in fact, established an office in Zagreb so that our activities can be effectively coordinated. Most recently, Croatian and tribunal officials have cooperated in exhumation of the mass grave of approximately 200 hospital patients slaughtered by Yugoslav army when the Croatian city of Vukovar was overrun in 1991. Croatia will continue its close cooperation with the Hague Tribunal, and it is dedicated to successful international effort to bring each and every individual guilty of war crimes in our region to justice. Let me also assure you that we are very concerned with the problem of refugee and displaced persons in our region. Croatia has cared and is caring for hundreds of thousands of displaced persons and refugees, most of whom are from Bosnia and Herzegovina. Indeed, in allocating $27 million for the resettlement of refugees and displaced persons, the United States State Department issued a statement on January 1797, estimating that there are still 2 million refugees and internally displaced persons from Bosnia and Herzegovina and 550,000 Croatian 550,000 Croatian refugees and displaced persons. For our part, Croatia has issued a standing invitation to Croatian Serbs who fled the country during Operation Storm to return. Remaining and returning Serbs will have the full benefits, the rights of Croatian citizenship. Overall, we believe that the Dayton process offers the best hope of lasting peace and stability in our region. Ladies and gentlemen, let me close by saying that Croatia supports the unity of Europe. It views the establishment of a new European security system aimed at preservation of fundamental human rights and democracy as a joint task. If the new Europe is to become a reality, the historic nations of both Western, Central and Eastern Europe and the United States will have to work together to integrate the newly emerging democracies of Central, Southern and Eastern Europe into a new and stronger security system. We truly believe that that will be not only for the benefit of the people from those countries, not only benefit for Croatia, Bosnia and Herzegovina, Yugoslavia, but also for the benefit of the United States and the benefit of the world. Thank you.
Mr. Ambassador, we thank you for what was clearly a very comprehensive, analytical, and dense presentation, very helpful to us. The floor is now open for questions. The question was, what exactly is a Croat, and specifically if one were to be by religion or culture different, a Muslim or a Orthodox of Orthodox religion, would that make a difference in being a Croat citizen?
There is actually two things that I have to, or maybe two constatations that I have to make regarding your question. What is Croat or Croats? That's nationality, which was established sometime 13 centuries ago on that territory, and which now inhabits mostly on the territory of the Republic of Croatia, partly on the territory of Bosnia and Herzegovina, some other countries in that region, and many of them living here in the United States, approximately 2 million or more than that. And what is to be citizen of Republic of Croatia? That means to be citizen of the Republic of Croatia with all kind of rights that citizen of any democratic states in the world can have. Without, of course, without, there is no democracy where division exists on a basis of religion or basis on nationality or any other basis. So that means to be citizen of Croatia, to enjoy full rights regardless of the religion. There are Croats, there are some Croats who are Orthodox religion, not too many, especially not recently, but some. There are a number of Croats who are Muslim by religion, but not only to them. To all people who believe that Croatia is the state that they want to live and who want to accept Croatian citizen and having right on that historical right and right simply because of the fact that they live on that territory, Croatia will and should be their homeland.
Yes, sir. Is Russia a threat to your area of the world?
I believe that process in Russia, and I'm hoping that it will go in a predictable way and that it will not be a threat. But if it goes in any other way, it will be a threat not only for our area, but it will be a threat for the world itself, for Europe and world itself, as I said in the first part of my speech. Speaking concretely for our region or our area, there are some historical differences among countries from former Yugoslavia. I don't want to say national or religious, but certainly historical. So it is the fact that Russia throughout history and then Soviet Empire and now new Russia, that they have always tendency to feel closer to some countries from former Yugoslavia, namely to Serbia and Montenegro. And that was the fact also now. So why am I telling that? I must be fair, and not only because of diplomatic reasons, but really truly be fair, and I am fully aware of that because I was part of our first official team to visit Russia in 92 after Croatia was recognized. We never had any problems in our bilateral relations. We do not have it now. We never heard any kind of threatening toward the Croatian sovereignty and integrity from the side of Russia. Again, to go beyond any kind of diplomatic answer, to tell you very frankly, I am not quite sure that all those in Russia who are maybe in position at least to speak publicly and to play political role, I don't know if they are completely uninterested what's going on in Serbia, or if their position regarding Serbia will be the same. I think that for the stability of Serbia or Yugoslavia and for stability of that part of the world, it would be much better if anyone, those who are actively, regardless of political position, in a political scene in Russia, is not looking too much on the other side of the border, whatever is the border, especially in the borders in our neighborhood, but I don't know is that case or not. I can mention you even some names, although those are names very well known to you, giving speeches in different parts of former Yugoslavia and stressing out how important is close relation between part of former Yugoslavia with current and future Russia. Again, we don't know what is real value of those speeches in terms of political forecast, but certainly it can influence up to some level. But again, if you ask me if I am concerned for the security of Europe, yes, I am, because of the processes in Russia. If you ask me if I am pessimist regarding that, my answer is no, I am not very pessimist, especially if United States and NATO will decide and fully decide and continue its role in the Europe.
At least a two-part question. Given the central purpose of NATO historically, a defense against the threat of the Soviet Union, what is today's role of NATO? And how do you think that the new NATO is important to the stability of Europe?
I slightly disagree with the constatation from your question, if I might, may. I know, of course, and many of us believe about NATO, first of all, as a military alliance. And through that the role of NATO was and will be in the future military one. And through that actually the biggest probably contribution of NATO was to stop Russian expansion or Soviet expansion in the time when obviously they wanted to do it if they could. But the part, so in that terms, I think that I agree completely with what you said. But I also believe that almost same importance was the other role that NATO play in the Europe, and that is development, stabilization, and the development of democratization in the all those countries, which if we look into situation, and that was only 45, 50 years ago, if we look how Germany looks in that time, how Italy looked in that time, how number of countries look in that time, I believe that it was much worse situation than it is now, for example, in Bosnia and Herzegovina. And I believe, I truly believe, that it was not only because of NATO, probably primarily because of the willing of the people from those countries, but also the help and the role of the NATO, that they succeed in only 50 years to come to the very, very high level, probably the highest in a current situation, level of democracy in Europe, stability, economic development. So I think that NATO once again can, and if you ask me, should play the same role. First, to give kind of military guarantee that whatever development in Russia or any other parts of the world will be. Finally, there are parts of Asia which are not so far from Europe and which certainly can influence situation in Europe. So wherever any kind of destabilizing factors happen, that will not influence the situation in Europe, I mean influence in terms of military threat. And on the other hand, that can help on the way how it helped to, for example, Germany, Italy, and other countries after the world, to give necessary stability and to give framework in which democracy will be developed. Looking from our perspective, from the perspective of individual countries, for example, there is quite often questions which are directed toward me when people are not so polite like you here or not want to have only discussion on very friendly level. They ask me, but do you have any arguments to prove that Croatia really want to be a democratic state? I think that our wish to become part of NATO is one of the best proof, because we know what does it mean. We know that without democracy there is no role and acceptance by NATO, and vice versa. So why am I'm telling that? Not because of myself, but because of the fact that whoever accepts that necessarily knows that by accepting, by wishing to become member of NATO, that's not only to have positive effects coming out of that, which we usually think in terms of stability and security, but also that means necessary and definitive decision to go in the development of democracy as the only model which can survive within that framework.
I think another aspect of the question was whether the NATO expansion has a negative impact upon relations with the Soviet, with Russia, or the integration of Russia into the European community. I think that was another facet of the question.
That's very difficult to predict. If NATO is fully involved, if Russia is fully involved in NATO, obviously that's not NATO that we are discussing about. That's some different institution and organization. So if NATO will ultimately ask Russia what to do, what not to do, I don't know, maybe that will be good and maybe that will happen one day, but I don't believe that that will happen in coming decades. On the other hand, if NATO is trying to do something which will obviously provoke anyway, very sensitive situation in Russia, it can do something which is against the purpose of NATO itself, and that's to give stability. I believe that a kind of compromise approach, compromise in a terms of time and not the terms of final results in accepting new countries, I think that that kind of approach can be really good in a way that it is leading toward final ultimate goal, but also not provoking Russia too much. I think that it is also bad, which unfortunately that's happening in Russia, that NATO issue and NATO enlargement is becoming internal political problem. An internal, not necessarily problem, but the way how people competing each other in their internal conflicts.
It's a question which I'm not able to repeat. Not not because of any problem with the nature of the question, but with my lack of knowledge. I think the question refers to fighting that's going on now. All right, the question has to do with the, yeah. And the ambassador will repeat the question properly. The question, the question has to do with whether there was fighting in a certain area, whether a particular church, the St. Mark's, had its roof damaged, and whether a museum, which interestingly your
a relative
has paintings there. Yeah, Mr. Ambassador.
Yeah, there are several questions connected with the locality in Croatia that I would be extremely glad if, but we are not prepared, obviously, to that. But we can do it in any occasion when you want. I would be, as I said, extremely glad to present how it looks and that you can see how beautiful are the areas that Madam was referring to. Especially Plitvička jezera or Plitvice lakes in middle Croatia. Unfortunately, that was the place where war, it's very difficult to say where war begin and in which localities in Croatia, but that was one of the localities where war started, and there were for 4 years controlled by Serbian paramilitary forces. Now it's part of Croatia. I am very, very glad and very pleased to say that it's not destroyed at all. It preserved natural beauty as before. And I am truly and really hoping that those who used to inhabit that part will come back to live normally, peacefully. And those who are wishing to see something really very unique, they will come to see it. Speaking about Zagreb, Zagreb was not seriously, almost not at all destroyed during the war. There were only two occasions or three occasions in which Zagreb was hit directly. That was first time when Yugoslav People's Army, at the beginning of war, when they tried to finish war by rocketing the President's Palace and by killing the not only president of Croatia, but actually all government of Croatia. And they almost succeeded in that. It is, being believer, I would say that that was only God's wish that didn't happen, because it was only, and this is historical truth, only maybe 5 minutes, because that happened, all those people, all members of government of Croatia were in that very room, which was hit by direct hit from the aircraft, Yugoslav Army aircraft. And that was very, very close to the church that you are referring. But church itself was not damaged at all. It was very, very precise hit, and from military point of view, very impressive. Again, thanks to God, without success. And second time, when when one completely not understandable and not military, but really criminal action was taken by leader of paramilitary Serbian forces in Croatia, Martic, when they decided to rocket Zagreb, simply streets of Zagreb, so they hit it with several rockets. Three of those rockets fall very close, for example, to United States embassy, and some completely innocent people were killed. But those kind of rockets, although I said at the beginning that I spent some time in the army, I'm not any kind of military expert. But what I know and what we know, what everyone knows, those were rockets designed to kill the people, not to destroy buildings or to destroy something. So whoever comes to Zagreb, I think, will be surprised that there is no any signals of war in Zagreb. That was even case during war itself. That is something very strange and unique. Not only in our situation, but I would say with our human mind and with our social life, we get used very quickly on something. So we used to live normally in Zagreb, and only something like 25 miles from Zagreb, real war was going on.
Would you estimate how long foreign troops, particularly U.S. troops, will have to be stationed in the region to preserve stability?
What I didn't say explicitly in my speech, but I think that implicitly was very much built in, but I will now dare to say quite explicitly. Personally, I hope that they will stay a long time, but not as any kind of peacekeeping or peacemaking operation, but as a friendly troops, part of the international alliance that we also belong. But I know that is not so. I'm not so naive to believe that is so realistic. But I'm also not naive to believe that everything in Bosnia and Herzegovina will be over 18 months from now. When we look into last year, in year after Dayton's accords were signed until now, everyone who is objective must admit that tremendous changes happened on the territory of Bosnia and Herzegovina. It's almost impossible to compare, because it's impossible to compare two opposite terms, and those two opposite terms are war and peace. A year ago we had war, now we have peace. And we have life, normal life, which is coming back to Bosnia and Herzegovina. What time is needed to stabilize that territory, because now we have troops who are even in their name saying, referring to stabilization forces, it's very, very difficult to say. Again, I do not believe that for complete stabilization 18 months is enough. I am one of those who believe that without American leading role, nothing will happen but continuation of the war. So I also believe that that leading role will continue. What does it mean in a terms of how many soldiers is needed? It's very difficult to say. Certainly some number, and probably not even so big number, maybe not more than 10% of the number that we have now on territory of Bosnia and Herzegovina. And for how long, if someone asks how long the troops will stay in Germany or in Italy after Second World War, I don't know how speculation was in that time. And again, this was not Second World War. It was in all aspects different, but there are some similarities. Hopefully long enough to keep stability and to prevent any new wars.
At least two questions. The first is, in your view, what are the major obstacles to the civilian side of the Dayton Accords, the domestic peace in a way, and what role does your government play with respect to the success of those agreements? And then beyond that, your second point was?
It's almost a more detailed, yes, coming down to, because Croatia will have probably a lot of influence on the Croats.
What's your government's influence on the success of the Federation?
Yes, what you said, it is. There is no doubt that is true, that military success was much bigger than civilian. But vice versa, it was impossible. If it was possible, we wouldn't have war. So I think that that was almost not only logical, but necessary way of development. And is 1 year really enough time to rebuild everything what was destroyed for 4 years of very, very bloody and very hostile war? Certainly not. And when we look from that perspective, to tell you very frankly, and as I said, somehow I was in position to monitor that from the very beginning. I'm surprised, even with civilian successes achieved until now. For example, if you ask me concretely with what? With the fact that that there is a presidency of Bosnia and Herzegovina consisted of all three groups who are trying to function. They are still not functioning in full meaning of that term, but they are trying to do that. And that was never case by, not only since the beginning of the war, since the break of Yugoslavia. They tried at the beginning, they realized, or some of them obviously had different options, different models, and they completely broke. So from the beginning of the break of Yugoslavia, we didn't have what we have now. Three group of people trying to, not necessarily, I cannot say to government the country together, but trying to do something together. And that is extremely big improvement. What are obstacles? Because of the fact that time, that for some things time is certainly needed, and there is nothing what can replace time. I think that very big obstacle is fact that that war criminals are still not only present on the territory of Bosnia and Herzegovina, but very much present in political life in Bosnia and Herzegovina. And, you know, all sides, including Republic of Croatia, is very often criticized. I don't believe with too many arguments, because the sides who signed Dayton Agreement cannot fulfill that part of the job. But, you know, that's like to I don't know if you have that expression in your language, to throw hot potato in someone else's backyard. There are very well prepared and best organized military forces on the territory of Bosnia and Herzegovina. And they can find and list you hundreds of reasons why they cannot deal with war criminals. And they are in the same time expecting that not organized, not prepared certainly for that part, army or police, which even doesn't exist, that they will be able to deal with that. I don't believe that that is very realistic. So I truly believe that international community must solve the problem. Finally, it is international problem. It is problem of everyone and each one of us, as well as that was problem again after Second World War. Not only problem of those who signed Dayton Agreement, because it's the question of our relation toward humanity and our relation toward civilization. I truly believe that. And I think that world must take the responsibility to do concrete action. Again, I am not big military expert, but from military point of view, I don't believe that that would be so difficult. Once that happens, I think that we will enter into new stage of development of civilian institutions of territory of Bosnia and Herzegovina. Not only because of the fact that those people who are now still politically active, that they are in position to prevent it or even sometimes to destroy it, but because that will create a psychological picture in which to everyone in Bosnia and Herzegovina will be very clear that this is something serious. And that there is no going back. So that Dayton, you know, there are expectations. There are many people, on the politician and non-politician, on the territory of Bosnia and Herzegovina, especially, but not only in Bosnia and Herzegovina, Croatia and Serbia, looking very closely what will be the result of the election in United States. And you know why? Because many of them, they were expecting that if the results of election would be eventually different, then that will be the end of the Dayton Peace Accords. Personally, I never thought that. I think that that is something which is not only a success of one administration, but really success of a world community led by United States. But what I wanted to say is that there are still those who, in back in their mind, believe that some other solution by the end of the day can appear. And especially as long as those who were somehow not only war criminals, and that is first category under which the world should treat them, but also political figures showing that there is possible other solution than Dayton Accords, as long as they are active, there is among some people still kind of idea that it's only what is needed now to wait enough, and after maybe 18 months, and finally what is 18 months in destiny of one people or one nation, some other solution can be found. Regarding the role of the Republic of Croatia, our role was and still is very complicated, to tell you very frankly. I always advocated, and I am among those in Croatia who believes that we must and that we must do everything what it is in our power to separate the problems of Croatia and of Bosnia and Herzegovina. Because I believe that with all similarities, that those are not the same problems. But on the other hand, we cannot and we will never say that we are not interested for what's going on in Bosnia and Herzegovina. As you know, one of the constituent nations of the territory of Bosnia and Herzegovina are Croats. They are looking very much in direction of Zagreb to see kind of even political guidance. We have also a responsibility because not only toward Croats, toward also Muslims and all other people on the territory of Bosnia and Herzegovina, but specifically regarding Croats and Muslims, because we signed jointly Washington Agreement, and that's what you were referring in second half of your question. And by that agreement, we signed that that was actually the beginning of process which finally was finished in Dayton, signature here in Washington between Croats from Bosnia and Herzegovina and Muslims from Bosnia and Herzegovina. And by that signatures, they established federation on the territory where they used to be majority before the war. But also, not only that we signed, and Croatia was also co-signature of that document, but we also signed the document saying that that one day that federation will enter into confederal relation with the Republic of Croatia. What will be concrete outcome of that, I think that it is now too premature to make any concrete prediction, but certainly it proves that we accepted that we will play active role and that we will continue to play active role. But that doesn't mean to confuse that we are two independent and recognized states, Croatia and Bosnia and Herzegovina. It's I don't know how clear was that what I tried to explain, because it's very complicated issue itself, and I know that people very often confuse the Dayton Accords with Washington Agreements, and people very often ask, so what kind of state now is that, having federation and then confederation and then one republic? But that is how is situation.
I wish we had more time. I think you've helped us, Mr. Ambassador, to make real progress in looking at the situation in that part of the world. And I think you've also, in the course of answering what I think were very good questions, given us a much clearer view of your country's path and your perspective on circumstances there. It's been a wonderfully educational evening. We're in your debt. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much.